Today we're taking a look at the items that came in Judges Guild's installment T from August of 1978. Please stick around. I'm AZ Mountaineer, and this is our channel, Old School Rules, where we celebrate the community of old school gamers and grognards, like classic RPGs, miniatures, magazines, and everything that goes with it. Today we continue our look at the bi-monthly installments sent out by Judges Guild. This month's installment includes three items: the Frontier Forts of Kelnor, the Judges Guild Journal, and their Fall Fantasy Catalog. Hope you enjoy the video. Our series continues today as we pull open the envelope and take a look at what came in installment T. The main product is the Frontier Forts of Kelnor. This is a booklet that has some maps and some charts and teaches you how to create some dungeons and forts for your players to adventure into. We have our newspaper, the Judges Guild Journal. This is the last one that came in this newspaper format. So we get out our coffee, we open up our newspaper, and we read all the interesting news about the industry. As has been the case recently, several letters and contributions from other judges around the country that send in articles and ideas. And finally, also in newspaper format, is the Judges Guild catalog. There were a couple of these that came like this, like a newspaper, and then they moved over also to folded paper with staples, that's sort of like in a magazine, you know, module size, magazine style format. We're gonna take a look at all these things today on our video. So let's start with a summary. 1978, this came in August. Bob Bledsoe is the primary driver behind the company, and I think generally that's who I sort of give credit for the journal, although if you watch the videos, you know there's a lot of people involved in that now, and there'll be an interesting article about who's going to be responsible for that going forward. The Frontier Forts of Kelnor is by Dave Sering. This is his idea. And then the catalog, obviously put out by the company. If you got this not through the subscription, but you just wrote in and wanted to pay for it, you wanted to get everything in the bundle, it'd be $3.50. And again, that's installment T. These installments keep going, by the way, several more here for several years. They'll switch from letters to numbers here after a few more installments. You've got the Judge Guild Journal, the Frontier Forts, and the Fantasy Catalog. Let's start off by taking a look at our journal, and you see the headline there, Journal Gets New Editor. And so that's going to be a big deal starting next time. They're going to switch to the magazine format, about 32 pages they estimate, and Chuck Anschel, who was the editor briefly for the Dungeoneer. Remember, Janelle Jacquez put that out, issues 1-6. And then Chuck Anschel, who'd been helping, I think, with the publication, took over and did like 8 and 9. And now it's moved over, Dungeoneer has moved over to being a Judges Guild product. And so Chuck has been brought in-house. He'll be responsible for both the Dungeoneer and for the Judges Guild Journal going forward. The circulation at the top remains listed as 2,200, and again, dedicated to swords and sorcery fantasy gaming. Again, no more mention of Dungeons & Dragons on the cover here. And this is issue 11, or letter T. So it made the mention about the article there and who that's going to be. It's quite long, but that's basically what it says, is that, you know, Chuck's going to be in charge of that. They mentioned that at this point, the Dungeoneer fanzine continues as well as the journal. And here's a little what's inside blurb from the first page. Some notes on ye olde process of learning, magical spices like salt and pepper, religion and justification of magic, robots, and other Judges Guild fantasy features. The first thing they have here is their people in the news, where they're just going to give you a little bit of background information about people that are involved in the hobby, and they pick Chuck Anschel. And they give you a little bit of background about how he came to be involved in fantasy games up through his joining of Judges Guild. Shrewd slants from the sagacious sage. And the major headline here is that a new book has come out from TSR, the Advanced D&D Player's Handbook. And of course, they say it's a fantastic book, and they think everybody, you know, needs to go and buy it because it has all the rules and all kinds of new things that are pretty significant expansion on what you had available to you, whether that was the white box of OD&D or the Holmes Basic set at this point. He goes through and mentions new character classes that are better spelled out, all the different types of information that's in here, and a really long list of all kinds of new spells that are here that weren't in the prior books. So here we have Swords and Sorcery Sagas, and this is England's summary of fantasy fiction for you. He has Stephen Donaldson's Lord Foulsbane, The Illyrith War, The Power That Preserves, and he gives a pretty exhaustive summary of the plot for each of these books. And once again, he encourages folks, says that these are all good books that you'd be interested in reading. The next thing we have here are coming conventions. WindyCon in Arlington Park, Illinois, Chicago, Illinois. NonCon in Alberta, Canada. World Fantasy Con in Arlington, Texas. Confulsion in Richmond, Virginia. RockCon 4 in Rockford, Illinois. Conclave 3, which is going to be in Romulus, Michigan, it looks like to me. CoolieCon, this is going to be in La Crosse, Wisconsin. WinterCon 7, Detroit, Michigan. And then the American Backgammon Championships are going to be in Las Vegas, Nevada. That one seems a little bit like it's out of place. But in any event, those are your coming conventions. So this article, Omniscient Opinions, by John Wheeler, is called What I've Experienced, Notes on the Process of Learning. And essentially, he's got a combination of here of a couple of earlier ideas about how to give you in the weapon sense proficiencies, but he divides you up into three ways that you have the ability to learn over time: knowledge, which are mental skills, physical skills, and then attitude. He says an attitude relates somehow to alignment. He doesn't really get into that. He says we're not going to talk about that. So we're basically going to give you knowledge-based skills and physical-based skills. It's kind of an interesting concept because when I read through it, with the benefit of history, what I see here is a sort of early idea of something that evolves and ends up being very similar to what you get in second edition Advanced Dungeons and Dragons. And so he says, look, your characters always two things. They want to know everything and be able to do everything. And he says, and you can't have that, really. That's not fair. And so to combat that, you need to give them some specific skills that they do know, in a way that they can learn those things, but also have limitations on what they can learn. So you can say, well, you chose to learn, to be a fletcher or an armorer or a sailor, but so you don't have any knowledge of gem cutting or map making or ancient lore, right? And so the characters really can't be upset when you give them some skills that obviously they don't have others. The way he does this for knowledge-based skills, he has a chart, and he gives you points based on your intelligence and your wisdom. And then for the physical skills, he gives you points based on your dexterity and intelligence. And so at 7 or 8, you get 0. At 9, you get 1. All the way up to, if you had an 18, you'd get 12. And so you'd get, you get that twice, right? Because you get your intelligence plus your wisdom, or you get your dexterity plus your intelligence. And you roll, and to start, you roll 2d6 on top of that. And so that's your basic skills that you could use sort of pre-adventuring time. He said he actually runs a session where your character starts, if it's a human, starts off about 12, other races, adolescent age. And you sort of play through the ideas of what skills you're going to choose to learn. He said it's a great way to sort of give a little flesh, a little background, and a little interaction among all the players and the dungeon master at the beginning, when you are learning all those skills. And maybe the players talk to each other about, well, wait a minute, we can't all pick the same 5 skills and then not have anything else. I thought what was interesting when you think about the 2E version of, for example, thieves, right, where they gave you points and you would allocate those to the thieves' skills rather than every thief going up every level the same. One of his physical skills, one thing he has in his physical skills are those thieving skills. So picking pockets, moving silently, hiding in shadows, climbing walls. Those are all things as a thief you would have to pick. I don't know whether he doesn't say whether he would let someone else do that. I would think that this isn't meant to override the existing rules, but sort of layered on top of it, right? So just like he has the ability to use pole arms, maces, axes, swords, etc. you know, his concept there for fighters, you don't know how to use everything. So you've got to pick the weapons you're going to learn how to use. He allows you to become an expert by doubling the amount of points that you spend. He doesn't say exactly what you get by being an expert in a particular weapon, so I guess that's for the DM to decide. He also allows two-handed fighting by learning both of the weapons that you would use in hand one and hand two, and then adding 1 to 4 additional points being spent, and also additional time being spent to train to be able to fight with two hands simultaneously. You know, again, lots of concepts there that make their way into 2E, I think. On the knowledge side, he's got things such as just general abilities to recognize things like weather patterns, edible roots, fruits, berries, recognize forest animals, types of rocks, and as he says, not magical items. These are just everyday items. The ability to discern noises, to know mathematics, cartography, first aid, singing, tracking, not like a ranger, but just generically tracking animals, wood skills like fire building and shelter making, economics, which is the true value of things, again, not magical items, reading, writing, speaking languages, lore around a particular thing. So he said it could be something very specific like swords, lawful Egyptian gods, jewelry. He's got one for alchemy. He's got one for philosophy, reading, writing, and speaking magical runes, which is different than, you know, the read magic spell. I think this is just more like Gandalf at the gates, right? The ability to sort of read different runes. Catechism, preordainment. I'm not really sure what that's going to do for your cleric. But so he's got those abilities, and then he's got a period of time based on your prime requisite that it's going to take you to learn those things. And then he has some combined sort of physical mental skills where it's like training an animal, sailing, disguising, using disguises, locating secret doors, being an apprentice at one of the secondary skills, or being a journeyman at one of those secondary skills. All different things that you would use and decide to use your points on. And then he gives you a certain number of points every time you level up. One idea he had in here, I think, was like you got 5 points every 5 points per level when you leveled up. So at like 6th level, you'd get 30 points. That seemed a little excessive to me. But I think maybe a set number, because I don't know why you would get more points, right, as you go up in level. But maybe a certain number of points, maybe 2, maybe 4. I guess it depends on really how many points you're needing to learn some of this stuff. Looks like the knowledge goes 1 to 7 points. Physical skills are from 1 to 8 points each. The combined skills go from 3 to 35, but mostly 3 to 9, just being a journeyman. And a secondary skill is really high. And I think the idea is there, unless that's the one thing you want to learn to trade and train and do, you're not going to have that level of skill at any particular craft. You're always going to have to hire people in town. But in any event, that's his idea. It's a pretty good idea, I think, all in all. And like I said, sort of preview of things to come later as D&D continues to evolve. The next article from Dave Cox is on magical spices, you know, like salt and pepper and paprika. And to be clear, he says there are spices, but these are magical versions of those spices. So you can still find the normal thing, but you can also find magical versions. I don't know where he came up with the concept of doing this, but then he gives them magical abilities. And so here's just to zoom in on a few of these, right? Magical carrots will give you dark vision for the rest of the day or time in the dungeon. Magical cinnamon increases your hearing. Magical cloves let you call forth an elemental to fight for you. That seems pretty extreme. Magical coffee. You have to brew the coffee and keep it warm, and then you can the party can drink it. It will stimulate you in combat for the next 3 full turns. Magical dill. If consumed by a lawful character, it prevents a hangover. Consumed by a chaotic character, it does damage. No effect on neutral people. I don't know what that's about. Magical oregano. When smoked, it will paralyze you into a statue-like position for 3 to 5 dungeon turns. But when you wake up, you'll be able to speak Italian. You know, so a little silly. There's a whole page and a half of this stuff. So all kinds of things to look at. Then Tom Holsinger is back with an article called Religion and the Justification for Magic. He starts with the idea that we've talked about before, where you know, magic in D&D is supposedly you open some rift into another dimension, you pull out magical energies. Only magic users know how to do that safely. But he says, you know, you need to understand how that works. He talks a lot about Empire of the Petal Throne as a good place to read and get an idea of the kind of detailed background he thinks you want for your world to explain your deities, to explain where things come from, the history of your campaign, and the types of things that characters can learn over time. He talks a little bit about the different types of alignments for clerics and the kind of things they would do and the interactions between deities and your clerics. You know, do they hear you? Do they interact? Do they respond to your petitions and prayers? Or are you going to be completely ignored? And he likes a world where the deities are particularly involved, whether that's through avatars, servants, or directly involved. He even has a little bit of discussion about the rules about what happens if a god comes and they're getting, you know, maybe losing a battle or for whatever reason they decide to flee and how they wouldn't be able to come back to a particular spot, which is sort of similar to the D&D rule, defeating a demon or whatever, where it's banished from the prime plane for a while, right? He also talks about the idea that some people could have allegiance to more than one god. He thinks that's okay. He sort of uses Conan as an example where he had interactions with more than one deity in those books. And then he also goes on to talk about magic in particular and says he really thinks you ought to use the Gygax model, where you use spells and they disappear from your memory, rather than something like spell points, which he seems to think would sort of break your game, which is, I think, what Tim Kask and Gary Gygax had said at different times about that concept as well. He has some thoughts about elves and dwarves and the fact that he thinks because of their long age, when you encounter them, almost all of them should be well leveled up, maybe 5th level, 7th level, whatever, maybe even up to the maximum level that's allowed in the player's handbook. And you shouldn't really, because of their age, you shouldn't really encounter, other than children, very many elves or dwarves that aren't, it's pretty decent level in whatever classes might be available to them. And finally, he encourages the Dungeon Master to create his or her own professions and drop those into the campaign as well. Prodigious plate mail. This is our letters column. So the first one here is Rusty Lamont, and he's invented this character class / race called Flareans. Interracial breeding. It seems like he's gotten this from some book somewhere. Breeding between Egyptians and nomadic tribe known as the Cold Watchers. He says if your character has a natural 18 in all the 6 abilities, they can be a Flarean. Well, that's sort of statistically impossible. And because you can't get it through any type of bonus, it has to be what you rolled up with your 3d6 at the beginning. But so it's an odd group, so they're going to have all 18s, right? They don't get any hit die bonuses. They do get a d8, if I remember. Yeah, they get a d6. 2d6 at first level, and then another d6 every level after that. Although a couple of times in there, they go up by 2. Hit dice in one level, which is a little unusual. There's some natural abilities. They cannot be seduced. They can lower, this is their big thing, they can lower the temperature 20 degrees around their body, and they can absorb heat basically from the environment, so they cannot really ever be harmed by natural cold. They go up in level, they can't be lied to, they can manipulate heat in fibrous materials, meaning they can cause something like rope to freeze and then so become so brittle it'll break. They can manipulate heat at a higher level in metal, so they can like freeze your armor, cause it to crack. And then when you use it, it can become damaged, lower the armor class. They could freeze your sword, maybe it would crack and break. And then they can manipulate heat in flesh, which means they can freeze human flesh. And they say in particular, they must be very precise. They can freeze the flesh around the fiber around the heart and kill somebody. You do get a saving throw, at least, for that one. Constant ability to detect alignment, constant ability to detect traps, or other abilities you gain as you go up in level. And finally, they have the thing they call the Dimension Stun. They can stun and send a 10 hit die, up to 10 hit dice monster into another dimension for 2 to 24 turns. And then they come back where they had left. So that's the general ability there of the Flareon. And they also get spells as they go up in level as well, either clerical or magic user, or combination. So for what that's worth. You could use that in your next campaign. Like I said, it feels like it came from a novel somewhere. Timothy Binder has Mighty Miscellany. These are magic items. So he has the Bracers of Score, usable by fighters or magic users. They are marked with ancient runes that no one can read. One says left, one says right. You have to put them in the right arm. And they give you three abilities. If you cross the right over the left, you can shoot out a 7-hit dice fireball. If you cross the left over the right, you can shoot out a 7-hit dice lightning bolt. And if you twist the left one, you will turn invisible. That's a magic user at level. A magic user, as long as the magic user who uses it is at least level 5 or the fighter is at least level 7. And so it says this odd thing here. The character can attack while invisible only if he uses the bracers as his weapons. I'm not really sure if that's technically right. I mean, meaning I'm invisible and then I attack. I become not invisible, right, anymore, usually with invisibility. So I don't know how the bracers know to turn it off until I actually do the attacking. But in any event, that's the idea. It seems a little overpowered to me, especially the 7-hit dice, fireball, and lightning bolt. The idea is pretty good. I'd probably find some lower-tuned magical abilities for it. He also says he has an ability he uses for psychic ability, which was mentioned in Installment K by Tom Holsinger. You roll a D. The idea is you have a 7th ability called Psychic Ability. You roll a D100, and what he does there is, on that chart determines what amount of magical competence you have, right? So 0 to 15, that player can't use magic items; just doesn't have the capacity or competency to use them. And as you go up the chart, you have the ability to use more and more magic items. So that's, you know, again, an option. And then finally, we have the ability, an added ability for magic users to go to special schools. And if you do that, it improves the chances of learning spells by 10%. So you sort of make an investment of time on the front end. You're going to have a little bit more background. So then when you get to make those rolls to see if you learn particular spells, you're going to get, you know, 10% bonus, which that seems like an okay thing to me. Robert Bingham suggests you could have robots. Creatures made by mad dwarves used to bolster their underground armies. His robots always attack, never check morale, and run on alcohol. Your hit points range from 10 to 100, and you have the ability to arm them with projectile weapons or something that's like mounted that swings around a 360-degree arc that can hit things, opponents on any side. So that's his robot. Erfung the Great. So this is a campaign sort of drop-in suggestion. And Erfung is an egotistical, self-appointed king who rules over the people of his little enclave. And here's our map. So it's just something you could drop in on in a hex. It's got the typical things, 3 or 4 different inns or taverns there, armorers, some soldiers, and this crazy guy who lives in the large building in the middle. He's not really going to do anything, I don't think, particular to the characters. I mean, referee could take that anywhere you wanted to, but it's basically just supposed to be a stop off with a colorful NPC. Then John Abrahamson has the Tanvil, a variant campaign. Now the Tanvil is actually a variant creature, NPC. And he gives a little backstory here. There was this island that radiated this thing called the Force. And you remember there was a different writer who suggested that this concept of the Force being something that existed in the world. So there was a strong emanation of the Force on this island. These people were particularly attuned to it and gave them essentially the ability to use magic-like effects. The rest of the people became, I'm shortening this, concerned. So they sort of like walled them off. Over time, the Force depleted. These people became sort of corrupted both in mind and body, for some reason the Force has begun to exude again, and so now they're sort of reinvigorated and they're trying to come out of their island. They figured out the ability to give themselves essentially like invisible wings so that they can fly out of the island and escape the watchful eye of the people who try to keep them contained on this island and come out into the world searching for nexus of force in other locations where they can absorb and use that power. It's an interesting thing because if they're around a little force nexus, then they're pretty powerful. But if they're not, then they're pretty weak, and they use disguises, and obviously they can fly away and try and escape. But he gives them, he has levels for them, so they sort of level up like a character class, but they're also sort of like a race, so it's a little wonky. Like I said, they carry these funky swords, and if they are near, around the force, it's like it attacks as a two-handed sword, but if they're not, it attacks basically like a dagger, just as an example. And he gives them some specific abilities that they gain over time, which these are kind of interesting. So their basic abilities, they have three levels, right? No, two levels. So the level one, they could pick, like magic users have to pick one or two or three of these depending on their level that they can use. One is they subtract their level in points from any damage that is done to them. So if they're third level, you know, you when you roll damage, you subtract three, so that helps them not get harmed. You could subtract the level of the Tanvil from every attacker's weapon or spell damage, which seems pretty similar to the other one, right? Except for it covers spell damage. Or you can reflect half the damage that's done back on the attacker, and then you would take half of that damage. Level two, if you have there's a race in here called the Sorgan, there's a gem imbued with the Force, I think. And if you have that weapon that's decorated with those gems, which you what they say you usually would, you take your level in points to every attacker every second melee round. In other words, that's an addition. So if you're fifth level, you do an extra 5 points every other round on any attack that lands. The second level two ability would be metal is melted. You can use your force power to melt metal up to three items per round of your choice. I'm assuming you get a saving throw under the DMG. Or the Great Thrust is your attack ability. So three times the Tanvil's level in damage is cost to every opponent. You can use it three times per day. So that could be a lot. Saving throws allowed, it says. I assume that maybe that means to most of these things to like cancel the ability. They also have advanced abilities, and that's semi-invisibility, which is like 85% chance to be undetected in the dark, 35% in shadows, 15% in daylight. Dispel magic or idiocy. One attacker can be made to become an idiot for three turns. Level two, Fireball, Charm Person, Charm Monster, Word Kill on one creature up to fifth level every day, or Word Kill any creature usable once a week. And then Self-Invisibility, or just Invisibility, Polymorph Self, Melt Rocks, Polymorph Other, Mass Charm. And then level four, use magic weapons that don't have any connection to the Force, use scrolls, use all types of magic items, ESP powers, or Mass Charm. Those would be the skills that you could learn over time. It's different. I'm not sure that this was particularly well playtested, but in any event, that's what they've got. And they've got some other rules about how to utilize this Force and figure out how to randomly roll and see whether any Force emanations exist on various hexes across your map. Okay. This is a short article by George Sommer called Daemons, and he basically says a fighter with a 16 or greater charisma could be a daemon if they're chaotic evil. They're sort of anti-paladins when you read the description. They can lay on hands except for its damage instead of healing. They can have an unholy sword. They can summon a horse. And then they can summon undead, which seems in particular pretty powerful. 1 to 12 skeletons or zombies, 1 to 10 ghouls, 1 to 8 wights, 1 to 6 wraiths, 1 to 4 mummies, 1 to 3 specters, 1 vampire. No indication of like how that levels up, or I mean, it certainly wouldn't think like just by virtue of deciding to say I'm chaotic evil, so therefore I'm a daemon, so therefore I can do all these things at first level. So it's a little thin on details for sure. And then finally we have Charles Segoy, who says Escalbar, hidden dwelling of the elves. And what I like about this is this is a building or a little stronghold specifically designed to go in a specific hex on the city-state map. Well, the on the Judges Guild map north of the city state in one of the forests. And he said, you got this forest, and I felt like there needed to be an outpost for people to who could get to and stop and rest in the middle of this forest. A haven, if you will. And here's his little map, and he's got, you know, indications of some of the major personalities among the elves, as well as the number of soldiers that exist around here. And he's got this kind of cool thing where there's one troop of these elves who have really great, exceptional infravision, and so they take up watch at night. And then there's another set of elves who have exceptional regular sort of long distance vision or sharp vision, and so they always are the lookouts in the daytime. And so you sort of get divided into the two troops and assigned your time of day that you're on duty based on your particular exceptional ability, which I thought that was kind of neat. We have a game review for the game called Cyborg. It's interesting because the first column and two-thirds of the second column are complaints about the things that aren't very good about it. But in spite of that, the game played well, and even with that, everybody really had a lot of fun, so we think this is a good game. So I thought that was kind of interesting. And again, this is a science fiction board game, not really a role-playing game. So a whole page here dedicated to, showing you where they are on the map, a couple of pictures of people. They do mention on the top left here, last time we talked about Citadel Fire, and they're like, hey, there's a whole page of text that didn't get printed, which is, if you remember, I showed you the second edition, and the third printing, and it had this extra language in there where it has the foreword and talked about the table of contents, and that was supposed to be in the first printing. It just was a mistake. It wasn't in there. So they give it to you here so you could insert it or at least know what it was. And then they've got the couple of pictures here. This is Bill Davis, who they called their Dwarf Lord and Distribution Manager. And then again, these photographs do not produce well. This says it's a hobbit thief hiding in the shadows under Mark Homer's drafting table. So I'm not sure if there's really a person there or what. You can't tell from the photograph. We have our booty list here. And we're up to 69 on here. But we're actually, when you look at these items, they take you up to 71. Here's the Space Quadrant ad, and just a random photograph here. This is for the movie Wizards. And then we have some more products from Judges Guild, as well as miniatures that are being sold from other people that you can get from Judges Guild. And then this is just the end of the description of the Sagacious Sage, where he's giving you the gigantic report on all those different books you could buy. And then there's a map of the Judges Guild campaign world and showing you where each of the numbered maps is in relation to each other. Here's some of the art that shows up around here. Most of this is by Cheryl England, or else has no attribution whatsoever. Some of it is repeated from a prior issue as well. And then these two, I think, might actually be clip art. I'm not sure they were drawn by anybody specifically for Judges Guild. Okay, so let's take a look at this really cool item here called the Frontier Forts of Kelnor. Got a cool little first page here with this little symbol. Our copyright page, our credits page. We get into our introduction here. The purpose of the installment is to provide your judge with a short 2 to 3 hour adventure in an easily organized and moderated form. Every time this installment is utilized, a different setup will occur. Each time, the physical arrangement of the fort ranges from slightly different to wildly different. Each time, the intrepid party has only a general knowledge of the layout of the old fort, knowing only what specifics the judge tells them as they encounter. The judge sets the scene for each adventure. This is an adventure-generating system. 3 complete examples of adventures are given, but an almost infinite number of variations are possible. The judge is provided with a framework, but must supply the imagination and drive to make the adventure work. The system provides for a graduated level of opposition to match the level of the party, and use of all the optional tables permits the judge to generate a detailed dungeon adventure, including specifics of room, contents, and traps. The optional tables also permit the judge to detail just those portions of an adventure that might be appropriate. Here's the background. In the elder days, once stretched the kingdom of Kelnor for many leagues across the land. To guard its far-flung frontiers, the kings of Kelnor built a series of forts surrounding the border. The king's master mason of the time had a great fear of the irregular, and so with his supervision, the serfs and peasants labored to make every fort exactly like the other. So that's why you get this sort of the same base, okay? But from these forts held by companies, professional soldiers, cavalry patrols, they all kept close watch on the surrounding countryside. For several centuries, the armies held the frontiers inviolate against marauding barbarians and hostile powers. However, in time, internal dissension broke out. Contending factions plunged the kingdom into civil war. The frontier troops were drawn into the struggle, and frontier forts were abandoned one by one. With the border undefended and the center in chaos, the kingdom was soon overrun by a horde of tribesmen, indiscriminately pillaging and burning. Now, several centuries later, the kingdom of Kelnor is known only from the scrolls of historians and legends. Many of the border forts still exist, some only in tumbled ruins, others occupied by various beings down through the years. Though originally built exactly alike, garrison commanders made certain changes on their own. After being ruined or abandoned, the forts have been rebuilt or altered by subsequent occupants. Thus, each fort is no longer exactly like others. The extent to which things are different now is what you're going to roll. So we got all these charts to let you do that, okay? Again, you have the basic plan he says you're going to start off with, and the way he designed it, the center page are these drawings we'll see in a minute. You can take the staples loose and pull those out. He says put it in plastic so people can see both sides, but those are protected. You can write on them with a sort of like a Sharpie marker, well, a erase marker, so it will appear the same, but then you can wipe it off every time. You can make those different changes in there. All right, so how does this work? So we start with the site or surrounding. So where does this particular fort sit, right? On a bluff, on a lakeside, a river, up on a plain, whatever. And then you say, well, what's it like? You want 1 through 6. Is it ancient ruins? Is it abandoned, deserted, occupied outpost? Or is it still a stronghold? And based on that, you're going to, for example, if it's an ancient ruin, you'll roll 4 times on the ruins table, once on the alteration table, once on the additions table. If it's a stronghold, which means it's completely intact, no ruins table rolls at all, but 3 rolls for alterations and 3 rolls for additions, okay? That's how that table 2 that goes across there is gonna be used. So you're gonna have some ruins, let's just say, right? So you have a D20 roll, tower, the roof is burned, the roof is collapsed, floors are collapsed in various places, walls are collapsed, things have been burned, the cellars collapsed, the courtyards, paving is broken and falls into a crypt, whatever it might be. Alterations, escape tunnels have been dug, crypts have been placed, storerooms have been combined, fireplaces have been removed, doors have been erected, walls have been built, so on and so forth. Next thing would be these other additions, you know, ditches around the walls, new watchtower built, stockade placed up, on and on. And then, so now we need to know, well, who's in charge? So this is a principal creature or leader based on the original 6, like was it ancient, ruined, abandoned, outpost, stronghold? You roll to see who's in charge here, right? Could be bandits, could be undead, could be some type of monster, whatever it is. I think this table 7 random location is like, where is the leader's sort of headquarters? And so it's different places within the building. What's that person's alignment gonna be? The leader's level, vocation, who their attendants are, secretaries, et cetera, et cetera. Then we have the general table of what's going on in here, you know, for every room. Is it empty? So they got these concepts, empty, disrepair, and there's a chart there for disrepairs, monsters, traps, treasures, insects, or a find. And for every one of those things, there's gonna be a chart. Okay, I got that banner for table 2 out of the way. And so you see the disrepair things. You get the monsters, there's different ones, sections A, B, and C, as to what type of monster you can roll in these different rooms. Then you've got a chart here for what they're calling finds. Those could be tools, machines, skeletons, armors, weapons, containers, utensils, apparel, harnesses, toys, optics, tomes, parts, scraps, statues, furniture, engravings, or idols. And there's even a couple of handicrafts and something else. So that's what you find there, just to give a little color, right? Something realism. And then different types of traps, cage, plane pits, deadfalls, gas, snare, liquid, slides, monsters, missiles, spikes, special trap, special pit. For every one of those things you get, you've got a chart down here, you do some more rolling, it'll randomly generate. Very Judges Guild-y, right, in the way they approach this. Okay, here are your central pages. So this is the base form. You've got a basement with some crypts. You've got your ground floor, courtyards, storerooms, mess hall, commander's quarters, stables for the horses, a tower for, you know, observation. Here's the second floor. You've got more barracks. You can look down into the courtyard. Of course, you've got the tower and a place to walk around the wall and have a look. And then at the very top, you've got a room as well as the room for the towers. That's the base form that you start off with. And then they go through and they give you three example dungeons, A, B, and C. So here, this is just, they've rolled this up and they've got it for you, right? So here's their basic information. You've got, you know, dungeon A, it's on an island, it's abandoned, and I think an ogre mage is in charge. And so they've gone on here and they've drawn things to show you the alterations in the dungeon. Here's dungeon B, it's on a rocky eminence. It's also an ancient ruin, and it is ruled over by a vampire. And they go through and they show you the different things that they've done to modify it with, you know, sort of dashed lines and pencil drawings to show you the edits that they would make, which they're telling you that's the kind of thing you would do. And here's an example, dungeon C on a rocky eminence. This is occupied and our half-orc is in charge here with a number of other bandit henchmen type guys. And again, they show you how they've drawn the edits based on the things that they rolled. So very good examples. And here's just all of it on one page, so you can maybe see it a little more cleanly if that helps with your visual. Okay, so that's the Frontier Forts of Kelnor. I think it's a really creative concept. Again, one of these examples of how you give the referee, the dungeon master, something that he or she can use to roll things up and make something up without nearly as much work. Just going to show you some of the cool artwork that's in this one. We've got this funky shield, which I like to think is maybe the shield of arms for Kelnor. And then we've just got a broken strap and some broken pottery here. The kind of things you would find. And then just a couple of cool pictures. Here's a giant snake head. Here's a giant insect head, because that's one of the things you can find, right? Or giant insects. And for whatever reason, he's wearing a necklace, but whatever. Random picture of a katana. Not sure what that's doing in these forts. And then we've got this trap. This is on the traps page, the little spring-loaded crossbow. And here's a random spear. And then finally, we have a couple of just random drawings that were in there. I think an ogre magi mage on the left and some other samurai looking person there on the right. And then finally at the back, we've got in the very back, we've got this thing. It says, "Hey, me laddies, first the frontier fortress and then the city state. The pot-bellied emperor is too full of swill to see danger upon his doorstep." And this is a drawing ball by Janelle Jaques. And those of you who've seen some of my other videos, in particular my early fanzine videos, will recognize this piece of art, which is really excellent, which was the cover of The Dungeoneer number 2. Fantastic fanzine. If you guys haven't seen those videos, you'll really enjoy it, I think. Here's our booty list. As you see, it goes up through number 72. This is the first printing that I've got here. This is the rear cover. It's just a drawing of a door. And here is the later printing of this. It has this color page. It would have been in like a Ziploc bag or shrink wrap. And there's a color insert. And then the actual front page of the booklet is black and white. And that's what the later printing looks like. Same content. Booty list is going to be a treasure vault, higher number, that kind of thing. But basically, same content. Okay, the last thing we got is this catalog, which is just, you know, a things for sale kind of thing, right? So here, let's take a look at that. Good drawing here of the Widowlands of High Fantasy. Gets some prominent display on the first page above the fold. And down at the bottom, Cheryl England has some really cool art here of a couple guys facing off in the street. So he says, "Welcome to the August 78 Fantasy Catalog. We have our own games as well as that of products for many other people." And for those of you who may be new to fantasy gaming and wonder what it is, we've got something written up to tell you a little bit more about it. Here are some highlights of Judges Guild products: Tack Cards, City State of the Invincible Overlord Ready Reference Package, Teagle Manor, our Judges Shield, Chronicle Cards, The First Fantasy Campaign by Dave Arneson, Campaign Hex System, Widowlands of High Fantasy, Thieves of Badabascor, Gen Con 9 Dungeon, Village Book 1, Castle Book 1, Island Book 1, and more. So here's their summary of, like, you know, what is a fantasy campaign. This, if you've seen the other videos, this is pulled from an article they had in an earlier Judges Guild journal, repeated here, just telling you about what is a fantasy, like, what is fantasy role-playing, how does that work, what games are there, where should I start, what's this all about. just gives you that. Again, it's just a reprint of that, but here for folks who maybe pick up the catalog who aren't reading the Judges Guild Journal. In terms of what's inside, you know, you've got this stuff we've been seeing as advertisements in a lot of our journals. We've got Grenadier miniatures. We've got the Space Squadron stuff, Judges Guild t-shirts for sale down here. Maps at our store, and begin to see these little pictures or artwork of the front covers of different items for Judges Guild along with their products. Full page of stuff for Frank Frazetta, his posters, you know, still for sale. Really, really cool art. And Frazetta was really the epitome of sword and sorcery, I think, back there in the 70s. We've got some Ralph Partha stuff with some of their miniatures being shown here, really early Ralph Partha series. And then we've got the TSR section, show you what they've got for sale. They now have the dungeon modules for the Giants. G1, 2, and 3 are listed in here for sale. The Geomorphs 1, 2, and 3, as well as outdoor Geomorphs being for sale. And of course, they have the Monster Manual and the Player's Handbook. We've got our booty list here for the Judges Guild. And we've got some cool art by Cheryl England, sort of sparsed around random places in here. We got this fighter, this, I don't know, barbarian looking guy. This is probably my favorite. I don't know what this thing is. This is by Bob Blitzall Jr. It's sort of like a dinosaur. It's got some people in the back, and it's got sort of a bird beak up front. So anyway, some cool random thing. It says it's Red Ark with Tower, but I don't really know what that's a reference to. Then this is from, remember, Gildea, who's getting, who did some of the drawings and some of the earlier Judges Guild journals. So we've got this elf warrior, I'll call it here. Maybe it's a thief, I don't know. And then we've got this drawing from Cheryl England, which is just a fighter coming out of a cave. And finally, Pixie Bledsoe has got this little drawing of, I don't know what these things are, a witch and an orc, maybe. It's creatures with the cauldron. They're cooking something. There's a chicken leg sticking up out of that bubbling pot. Okay, that's it for installment T. That's the last time we have the newspaper style. Next time we will have the, I guess they're calling it a magazine style Judges Guild Journal. I'm probably going to take a little bit of time off from the installments now and catch up on the items that were not sent to subscribers, right? These are the things that Judges Guild produced and just had for sale directly from Judges Guild, but you had to buy them. They didn't come in any of the installments. So I want to catch us up on that before we get too far ahead in time. And then we'll come back to the installments once we do that here for a few videos. Hope you guys enjoyed today's video. Hope you're enjoying our series, and I hope you're subscribed. If you're not subscribed, I hope you will, and I hope you'll find some friends who might become subscribers as well. That's it for today. Hope you have a great rest of the day. Till next time, my friends, keep rolling 20s.